Welcome back to Physical Anthropology. This week we're going to be looking at modern human variations. Chapter 13 will focus on race and human variation and introduce you to this topic. And then chapter 14 will go into a lot more detail on some specific examples. So for chapter 13, topics we're going to cover is what is the definition of race? What are modern concepts of populations? And phenotypic traits that reflect selective and neutral evolution, including the example of skin color and blood types. So what actually is race? An important thing to understand about race is that it is a social definition, not a biological one. So according to the dictionary, you can define race based on things like physical characteristics. You can look at the biological origin of a group, for example, their nationality. You could look at the different social qualities of that group, such as culture and language that they share in common, values that they share in common. Sometimes people group each other by religious affiliation. And the important thing is that depending on your definition, the same individual might fall into multiple different categories. So there's a lot of variation in terms of how we define a person and what category we put them in. So it's important to understand that race is not a set condition. It's something that is defined by our social background. Now, the reason I'm mentioning this is because historically, when we first looked at differences amongst populations and we were looking at superficial physical differences like skin color or facial features, people believed in something called biological determinism. And that was the idea that these different groups would have differences in things like their genes and their brain size, and therefore, you know, one might be more intelligent than the other, one might be more advantageous than the other. And this resulted in a process called eugenics, where people were thinking, oh, certain groups of people are better than others, let's only let those guys reproduce, and then let's sterilize or basically impede the reproduction of these unfavorable groups. And there are definitely laws throughout the world that promote certain, you know, in quotation mark, races being better than other races. And so even in the United States, we saw laws against interracial marriage because the idea was that these groups should stay separate and not be allowed to interbreed with each other. We also see examples in history of forced sterilization of certain individuals and also the genocide of entire groups of people where they were killed off because they were considered to be unfavorable. And that brings me to the next two vocabulary words, just to understand kind of the difference between them. So prejudice versus racism. Prejudice is anytime you have an attitude towards a group that isn't really based on reason. It's not based on you actually interacting with these people and understanding them. Instead, it's just based on stereotypes that you associate with that group. And prejudice can be on a number of different factors. It doesn't have to be race. It could be based on the individual's sex, on their age, on their religion, any number of factors where you come up with this negative feeling towards them because of stereotypes that you've developed. Racism is specifically the discrimination based on the racial perception of that person. And unfortunately, you know, these concepts definitely are alive today. There's plenty of people who, because they have not interacted with other groups, have certain ideas about them and use that to justify negative actions against them. But let's not talk about the anthropological idea of distinguishing amongst people. What we really look at is populations. So you may remember in our topics of evolution, we talked about microevolution and the idea that a population is an interbreeding group. So human populations exist throughout the world where certain indigenous populations would only interbreed amongst their own kind, whether that was relationships based on language, relationships based on shared culture and values, or sometimes just geographical distances. However, these populations are not subspecies. All human species are the same species. There's enough gene flow amongst the populations to keep us the same and to allow us to have fertile offspring regardless. We also see that if you do some DNA studies on these different populations, populations that you might consider to be one race versus a different race, if you compare them, there's actually very little difference between them in terms of DNA, while within the racial group, there can be some extreme differences. So that's just showing you that the evolution of humans is quite complex. And using the term race, even though there is a place for it in society, we do have demographic types of questions when we look at things like healthcare or access to different resources. But again, remember, these are social constructs rather than biological ones. We also know that human variation is continuous rather than only being Mendelian, where there's like two types, right? One versus the other. There's a lot of intermediate stages. And we've seen this graph before about the idea of human skin color. So human skin color follows a cline, meaning there is continuous variation. And you can easily see that it is related to the amount of sunlight that the people in that region of the world were exposed to. So this is also an example of natural selection. People who live close to equatorial zones with direct sunlight are going to need more melanin to protect themselves from that strong UV radiation. And they need that to make sure they don't get sunburns and skin cancer. On the other hand, as our ancestors migrated out of Africa and they started going to these more northern latitudes, you get less and less sunlight. And one of the consequences of that is that we need sunlight to synthesize vitamin D in our skin. So we actually produce our own vitamin D, but only if we have enough exposure to sunlight. And in the northern latitudes, we don't get that much sunlight. So having dark skin there would actually be a disadvantage. It would cause you to end up with a vitamin deficiency, which causes disease. So in those groups that lived there for long periods of time, eventually the evolution of lighter skin tone is seen. We also see, of course, that when we migrated across here from Asia all the way over here to Africa, then we're going to see the redevelopment of the darker skin tones as you move further south. So going back to the idea of the genetic diversity, we have a lot more in common than we have that's different. So 99.9% of the DNA is the same between all humans of this of our species of Homo sapiens. And that 0.1 difference is really a lot of superficial differences. Things like I said, skin color, hair color, and eye color, those are all based on melanin production, which is a very few set of genes that control that. We also see, of course, differences in facial features, whether it's nose size, which we've talked about being related to the climate, but also some things like ear size and shape or lip size and shape. It may not be a matter of natural selection. It may have just been an example of genetic drift in that population. There is a study by Richard Lewontin, which showed that most of human genetic differences were found within local subpopulations. And again, the idea that it's disproving that traditional definition of race as being a biological phenomenon. This map is showing blood types. So the reason this one is interesting is because the ABO blood group is controlled by the gene for the A protein or the B protein. And what we see here is evidence of different types of migration patterns. So for example, in the first graph, we're looking specifically at the A allele. So what's the likelihood that the A allele is found in this population? And as you can see, as you move away from Africa and to this northern climate, you have a higher and higher and higher concentration of the A allele, but you can see that there is still a gradation there. So that's evidence that gene flow is still happening amongst these populations, but that the further the geographical distances, the more challenging it is for those groups to interbreed. Therefore, you're starting to see a concentration up here in this northern area of a lot of the A allele. And then you can do the same thing for some of these other alleles as well. So for example, now let's focus on B allele in this bottom graph, same idea. As you traveled further east, the concentration gets higher. However, the individuals who moved here to North America clearly did not have this allele because in the North and South America, there's very, very, very low possibility of an individual of that indigenous group having the B allele. This kind of is an example of something called a founder effect, right? We talked about founder effect before, so that the individuals who actually crossed through Central America all the way to South America, these individuals simply did not have that allele, therefore their descendants also do not have the allele. So my review question for you, all human beings on Earth share blank percent of their overall DNA. Do you remember what it was? So it's a very high percentage. 99.9% of our DNA is the same. You might recall chimpanzees and humans are 98% the same. So again, those small mutations and differences add up to create the observable differences. Final thoughts, don't forget about the out of Africa model, the idea that our ancestors came from Africa and then migrated to these different continents. Some additional evidence for that, we talked previously of mitochondrial Eve and the Y chromosome Adam. So we know we have a common ancestor in Africa. But when we study populations who currently live in Africa, we see that there's actually a lot of genetic variation there versus if you study populations in Northern Europe, there's less genetic variation within that group. What does this mean? Genetic variation takes time to accumulate because mutations occur slowly over generations. Therefore, this lets you know that the people in the Northern Europe have been in that location for less amount of time than the people who live in sub-Saharan Africa. And that wraps it up for chapter 13.